Cumbria is a wild and beautiful part of Britain. And to live out in this rugged place would be, well, it'd be wonderful. But surely a brand new house would stick out like a sore thumb here and spoil the view for everybody. Well, this week's people aren't going to build their dream home in this landscape. They're going to build under it. And this is where the house will be going. A disused sandstone quarry in the Eden Valley, with a house-sized gap conveniently quarried out over 100 years ago. The plot has spectacular views. And it's been bought by a local vet, Helen Gould, and her partner, Phil Reddy. Both are keen environmentalists, so they're planning to slot an earth-sheltered eco-house into the hole.
Is there an emotional reason for building here into the side of a hill, into the earth?
Well, there is, yes. I mean, there's something really appealing to me about being within, held by the earth, I guess, you know, being buried away. We'll get this wonderful, peaceful nature of the buildings, but we're also hiding away in the sense that we're not imposing ourselves on the landscape in a way that all too often buildings do.
Yeah, that's true, yes.
But is it for you important to feel rooted in this way?
Not as important, no, because I feel quite rooted in the community anyway.
Because
being
the
local vet, yes. In fact, I didn't really quite fancy the idea of an earth-sheltered house, first of all. I wanted an eco house, and I didn't really mind what sort of eco house it was, as long as it was.
Yeah.
And we looked at the various performance of different types of eco house, and earth-sheltered houses come just way above the others.
So, does this buttress go then?
Yeah, it does. Yes, that's definitely got to come out, and,
right.
And the walls have got to be taken back a little bit to straighten them off.
Okay. Even yeah. So, it doesn't seem like a huge site, this.
No, it's not really.
That's a slight concern. We look at it and think, can we really fit a whole house into a space this big?
The three-bedroomed eco-house will be slotted into the hillside and buried under tons of insulating earth. To gain as much light as possible, the south-facing elevation will be entirely glass. The house will be upside down, so the bedrooms will be on the ground floor behind a large conservatory area. The living rooms will be upstairs. The back of the house, which potentially will be very dark, will be lit by sun pipes. The layout means that from the main living area, you get to see those glorious views. The build also includes a separate one-room veterinary space. This element was crucial in getting planning permission. The budget for the build is 220,000. The half-acre site costs 23 grand, and it'll be paid for with capital from the sale of Phil's previous house and an Ecology Building Society mortgage. The schedule is an economical 22 weeks. It's going to be a challenging year because Helen's expecting a baby.
You're having a baby as well.
As well
as
baby
giving birth to a house, you're getting birth to
yes.
The baby's
slightly easier than the house.
So it's the man.
I'm not building. Due in August.
Yes, the beginning of August.
But your house won't be ready for
another four weeks. The end of August.
At least.
Yeah.
Oh, it will be. It'll be ready. We've got
everybody says that.
It's generally accepted in the building trade that once you've got your foundations built, from then on, the build's straightforward. You're out of the ground. The trouble, of course, with this build is that they never really do get out of the ground. It's April the 3rd, and the build's starting. This idealistic, eco-friendly project kicks off with a bit of destruction. The first thing to do is dig out and enlarge the hole where the house is going to go. They need to lose up to 7 meters off the side of the rock face and dig at least 3 meters down to position the house. Because of all the heavy machinery, this phase of groundworking is costing Phil and Helen almost £4,000 a week. So, the pressure's on. There's a lot of enthusiasm and goodwill on this unusual project, but not a lot of experience. Neither the architect, nor the project manager, nor the structural engineer has ever built an underground house. The architect, rather ominously, is called John Bodger.
You know, Phil and Helena have got to be slightly mad living in a hole in the middle of Cumbria, designed by an architect with a surname like mine. I mean, you might say that was the kiss of death, but in fact, I think they're very switched on. The notion of living in holes in the ground, I mean, it's nothing new, and it's, you know, caveman did it, and in ancient Turkey, there were underground cities with hundreds of thousands of people living underground. One way that I like to think of it is that in days of the caveman, man lived in caves to protect himself from the environment, whereas now Phil and Helen are going to live in a hole in the ground, in a sense, to protect the environment from the effects of man. It's a nicely gone full circle.
I have to say, the first part of the build was a bit frightening in a way, because it was worrying to see how quickly our beautiful bit of hillside was transformed into a building site, really, which it is. But you can see it from miles away. You can see the red soil from miles and miles away, and it's quite a blot on the landscape at the moment.
They're only a week in, and there's a problem at the vet space. They've discovered an enormous underground hole, 3.5 metres across and 3 metres deep. It poses a real problem for the project manager, John Trengrove.
Quite a serious problem. It's going to delay the project, I would think, a week or 2 weeks on here before we can do anything to decide. The options that we've got are to fill it up with concrete or to move the building. And then obviously there are concerns of whether there may be other holes in the area.
Later that day, they unearth another hole on the other side of the site.
Well, it's very similar to the other. There's this shaley clay. It's about 3.5 metres along, about 2.5 metres deep, but very, very similar. It's been formed in the same manner as the hole that we've seen across there.
These are naturally occurring voids, solution holes formed by water where sandstone and limestone overlap.
Wouldn't mind betting that there are some more.
Yeah. You know,
but they need to be dealt with. Work on the vet space is halted while John Trengrove and John Bodger scratch their heads.
Whilst that was worrying in a way, and it's going to cost us a bit more, it was also kind of quite nice in a way as well, because it's like the earth is still exerting its own character, whatever we're going to do to it, which is comforting, really.
With nothing happening on the vet space, manpower is redirected to the house. Insulation is going down on top of a base layer of concrete blinding. Phil and Helen will have no heating in this house. They won't need it. The house will be super insulated, both by the earth, which covers the concrete blockwork, and 300 millimetres of blown foam insulation, which will envelop the whole structure. This is 6 times the insulation used in a normal house. Next, a waterproofing layer goes down on top of the insulation. The first rule of an underground house is that it must be watertight. Any leak could be catastrophic, because there's just no way of repairing it once the building's buried. The layers need to be meticulously measured and overlapped by a specialist firm. After much debate, they found a solution for the vet space.
And we're going to have to move the veterinary bed, this part of the building. We're going to move it down the side. And probably, what I don't want to do is, if we move it too far down the side,